couple of days ago, I made a short video on server meshing. I realized when I was rewatching that video that I skipped over a couple of pretty important elements. Now, this video will be far more technical than the last. I'm going to do my best to make sure it's still consumable and approachable. One of the key items that I didn't address in that was the difference between 3D space and graph. And I think we need to start with that. So what we're looking at here is a graph. This graph I threw together this morning just to give us something to talk around. Please don't take this in any way as an expression of what they're doing within the context of Star Citizen. If we focus in on the center of the graph, we see that Stanton becomes the root of this graph. The planets, Microtech and Crusader, the examples I chose, are related to Stanton. And Microtech City and Orison are related to their respective planets. Now, this doesn't address the 3D space, and there are thousands of ways that they could possibly do this. I'm sure they have spent months thinking about this when I haven't, but this is the first point where I want to express, you can't just do this. This is not a decision that can be made lightly and you can change on a whim. Do they have a complete contiguous 3D coordinate system such that Stanton and Pyro exist within the same coordinates? Or do they break those up and each have their own coordinate system and you need a jump gate to get between them? I would assume it's a complete coordinate system. Otherwise, they wouldn't need a 64-bit number. To represent this, I've added objects that are called bounds. This boundary defines what each object's responsible for. So Stanton has a certain area of space, that anything that happens within that area of space has to happen under the context of the Stanton rules and procedures. Pyro has its own area of space. Then there's Microtech and Crusader. They're each going to have a subset of the Stanton space. And I assume that Stanton would be where they would do anything that happened, say, between planets, spheres of influence, or moons, or what have you. For instance, quantum interdiction would happen between two planets. There has to be some method for managing that. So there has to be some denotation of that in the structure. Next, let's focus in on the detailed side of this graph. So in this, we have Microtech City, the spaceport, Hangar 2 is in the spaceport, my ship, the Octavius, is in Hangar 2, and my player, Tibio, is within the ship Octavius. This is all very straightforward, so let's take a bit of a more detailed example. So what I've done here is my player contains objects. In the initial views, you were seeing that what we call collapsed. So it was not drawn out, all of the objects contained within. I've expanded that out, and you can see now that my character has an undersuit, chest, arm, and legs for armor, a backpack, and in that backpack, there's some bottles of Cruise, because always. This is a way to represent that these objects exist. Every time someone creates a bottle of Cruise, we don't want to have to create a whole new object with all of the attributes of Cruise. If we define Cruise as an entity, an object in the database, and then we apply all of the values to it. How much health do you get for a sip? How much hydration do you get for a sip? How many sips are there? What does the bottle look like? Is the wrapper green or orange? What's the animation we use to open that bottle? All of these things are the same for every bottle of Cruise in the universe. There's no variation here. If we need to change one of those things, say we want to upgrade the labeling so it has a higher resolution, or we want to change the animation, so what happens in most cases is you get this next set, which are parents. And in this case, I've just have a drink parent. So Cruz, the entity I have in my backpack, is parented to drink. When we're talking about the Cruz object in my backpack, it has maybe one or two values. The number of sips that are left. Everything else about that bottle of Cruz is what we call inherited. It's inherited from its parent object. That keeps the database small. It also means when you want to create copies of something, all that's needed is two or three simple calls. I create the object, I put it in a space. So I create the object in my backpack and I parent it to drink. And that's it. That's all I have to do. Instead of I have to copy the object, I have to manage the duplication, I have to give it a unique ID because it's this bottle of Cruz versus that bottle of Cruz. So that's why in the demo, they were able to push the button and dump a bunch of plushies in there, because all they were doing was creating a plushie ID and linking it back, I assume, to some sort of parenting or inheritance structure. Where this really gets complex is I'm sitting in the ship, Octavius, and that ship is in the hangar. When I fire it up and the doors open and I'm allowed to proceed, I can move out of that hangar, and then that line from Octavius to the hangar needs to move. There are two different operations that could happen at this point. One, that line could move within the context of the server that the zone is in. Let's say that the Microtech City instance with its boundaries has the spaceport and the 3D space above the city as its ownership. Octavius would fly out of the hangar and the link would move from Hangar 2 to Microtech. And then as I flew up and out of Microtech City, that link would move from Microtech City to Microtech Planet. The other way this can work is if in the dynamic world, Microtech is overloaded, let's say IAE is going on. So Microtech City is actually split into multiple bounded regions. When I fly out of that spaceport, I might be moving between server instances. So they might be on the same server. So it could be, you know, two processes or two services running on one server. And they do the handoff locally between the two without any knowledge at all. I fly out, I keep going, and the handoff happens fast enough in the background, and I just go on. If you were watching me fly out of the hangar from the maglev, you're on the second server, I'm on the first server. When I fly out, how does that look seamless and straightforward to you and to me, all at the same time of keeping track of physics? So let's say there's someone else hiding under the bridge with a anti-aircraft missile, and they shoot at me while this translation is going on. So now you have three players, a ship, two servers, and a missile, all while this is happening and has to happen seamlessly. What happens today is just with frame desync. Not even with any of this complexity, you shoot someone, they take three steps, then they go backwards a couple of steps and fall down dead. That's the desync we deal with today. As the physics engine is flying that missile through the 3D space towards the ship, when it hits, who is the owner? And if it's still the hangar or the server that's running the spaceport, how do you incorporate that into that handoff to the Microtech City server, who is going to have to deal with the ship blowing up and all the parts falling down? And what happens to parts that then blow backwards into the hangar? That Microtech City server then has to create that debris, and for each element of the debris, it has to pass that back to the spaceport instance. A lot of this incorporates persistent entity streaming. That's why it's foundational, right? That's the method for how this will occur. So I hope you're starting to get a feel here for just how complex this can be. I mean, that's one of 1,000, 10,000 different possible situations that the system they're building will have to handle. And because they're doing it in a way where it's dynamic and it will have a set of rules to operate on instead of procedures that are pre-programmed, that's, to my knowledge, never been done before at this scale. It goes back to what we're looking at here, watching this evolve, is an iPhone moment. We have had decades of MMOs, all the way from MUDs and MUSHes to, you know, WoW, Elder Scrolls, Anarchy Online, Dark Age. You know, you can just rattle these things off forever. They've each tried to pass the boundaries of this, but the technology wasn't there for them to do it. What CIG is doing here is they're taking over 30 years of experience and trying to take it to the next level. They're trying to create the iPhone. While I don't think they deserve a free pass by any stretch of the imagination, I think it's incumbent on us, the early backers, to respect what they're trying to do and to understand the complexity of it. Now, that doesn't mean I give them a pass on their interesting styles of communication over the years, or their operational failures, or the limited understanding we have as to how it took 10 years to get here. I think we need to combine the two. There is no black and white. They are doing something amazing, and I can recognize that at the same time that I hold them accountable for doing it badly. But I haven't given up hope. That's what I hope you take from this. Thank you for your time. If you found this valuable, please like, and if you want to see more, please subscribe.